And Arcane Saints Never Say Die. And they are, of course, from Melbourne. And I do have Michael on the phone with me right now. Hi, Michael.
Hello, Kat. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm rather good, thank you. I'm sitting with a glass of red wine, chilling.
I'll swap
having
places.
A fantastic evening.
Oh, that's good. I'll swap places with you, all right?
Yeah, for sure. Come over. There's still half a bottle left.
Oh, cool.
You got to be quick, though.
Yeah. I have spoken to you before, and you were raised partly in England, weren't you?
No, I was actually born in... I don't think we have spoken before. I think you spoke to our drummer previously. No,
I think we spoke last year.
Did we?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure we did.
Maybe I've had a few too many of the...
The red wines.
Red wine. But anyhow, no, I was actually born in England, but I moved to New Zealand when I was a little baby.
Yeah, because I can hear that Kiwi accent coming through a bit.
Can you?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've been here almost 8 years, actually, and yeah, it's a bit watered down, but yeah.
Oh, well,
some people can't pick up, but some people can spot it straight away, so.
Well, you've had a massive year. You got invited over to Nashville to record your debut album.
Yeah.
By a Grammy Award-winning producer who's worked with Metallica and Kiss. That's Toby Wright, his name was. What was that like?
Really expensive. No, it was really cool. It was a really awesome experience. We sort of didn't really know what we were getting ourselves into when we went over there, you know, working in this big, you know, super producer who'd worked with so many of our rock idols, you know, like Korn and Kiss and Metallica and Alice in Chains, you know, all these bands that we grew up listening to. And then we were like in a studio with this guy, and it was kind of like, at first we were kind of pinching ourselves, just thinking, well, you know, who are we, like this band, this little known band from Australia working with this guy. But after, like, you know, a couple of days, he just became just Toby to us, and he's really down to earth, and he's really easy to work with, and we learned a lot. And it was really, really hard work as well, because we're on such a short time frame and budget, and we just worked our asses off over there, but we're really happy with the finished product, and it's got really good, mostly really good reviews, and it's been really well received, so yeah, we're pretty happy with it.
Yeah, and did you do any live shows at all while you were over there?
No, we didn't. No, we didn't have any time. I actually had to come home before the album was even mixed because I had to go back to my day job. But half the band stayed there and looked over the final mixes and stuff. So. And luckily they didn't muck it up, so that was good. But yeah, no, we didn't. We didn't. But we're going back next year to do some shows.
You actually have got some sort of management deal over in America, haven't you?
We do, actually. We do. We, as a result of working with Toby, we came back to Australia and we were kind of like, okay, cool, we've got this really good album. What do we do now? And we're kind of sitting around twiddling our thumbs going, oh, yeah, you know, what's the next step? And then luckily through one of Toby's contacts, he had sent him a copy of the album and he really liked it. And he looks after some big-name bands over there, like Trapped and Head PE and a few others. And he got hold of our CD and was really keen on working with us, so we signed up with him. And as a result, yeah, we're officially on his roster from January, so he'll be looking after getting us radio play over in the US and also our first big tour over there with a fairly big US band that we're not allowed to announce just as yet.
It's not one of the ones you just mentioned?
I can neither confirm or deny.
If it's Head PE, can you fit me in your suitcase?
Yeah, for sure.
That'd be cool.
Oh, well, you can just be like a merchandise person or something.
Oh, yeah, I can do that.
Yeah, there's always a job to do, you know, or whatever. party liaison officer, perhaps.
Yeah. Wine uncorker.
Yeah, there you go. But, yeah, so that's when my May or may not be with one of those bands that I just mentioned. But, yeah, it'll be for the whole month of May. So we're really, really excited and looking forward to that. There's some really good things coming up.
Yeah, because in January you are actually doing the local stage of the Big Day Out Festival in Melbourne.
Are we?
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool.
You know that.
Yeah, someone told me. Yeah.
No, that's good because you had a bit of help with that competition from some big names again.
Did we?
Didn't you? You're being all shy of me now. You had Pink and Katy Perry helping you out.
Yeah, we got quite lucky, didn't we? We won a competition to play one of the stages at Big Day Out, which is really cool. It's partly public voting based, and then once you got through the public voting round, the industry judges selected 3 bands out of 10, and we were one of the bands, so we were pretty lucky. And yeah, we did. We had some friends of friends who happened to be celebrities, and they, I don't know, do you want me to name drop?
Yeah, I already did.
Katy Perry, Pink, Paramore helped us out and gave away free tickets to their shows for people who kindly voted for us. It was an extra incentive, so we're really, really lucky in that respect. But, you know, it was one thing, they got on board and they were helping us out, so we're talking to them, like I was talking to them pretty much daily, and, you know, just about the, how the competition was going and general stuff like that, and it's kind of in the back of my head, well, you know, what if we get all these votes and we get through the first round, but then the judges don't pick us? It's going to look really bad, you know? So the night before the announcement, I was like a nervous wreck. I was just going, oh, come on. Because I didn't actually have a good feeling about it, because we're one of those bands, we don't really have good luck. We always have sort of a lot of bad stuff happens to us for some reason. Maybe we're all really bad in a past life or something. But so we're just kind of like, oh, this is going to be another time where I can't get shafted or whatever. But no, sure enough, the tide is changing.
Well, that's what I was just going to say, that maybe the tide has turned, and your album is called Turning the Tide.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's a good name for an album.
Yeah. Did you come up with that because you felt like it was turning around for you, or has that just happened since?
No, but it could also relate to that, couldn't it? No, why did we call it that? Oh, we called it that because I guess it was kind of our... Well, I guess it is partly that reason. It was more like the tide's turning as in... Well, we're doing our first album now, you know, this is getting pretty serious and we're sort of putting everything into this, whereas before it was just kind of, you know, you do the odd single, the odd EP, and now it's like we're putting all of our funds, all of our attention and going into Nashville, trying, I think it was more an attempt to turn the tide, and it was also like a tongue-in-cheek thing about, you know, rock and roll not getting the recognition that it deserves, so it was kind of like our little contribution of, you know, trying to get rock and roll where it should be.
Yeah.
Back to the mainstream or whatever. So it was kind of, you know, not in an arrogant way, but it was just our little, you know, our drip in the massive ocean, you know, contributing to that, trying to turn the tide of what people listen to these days, I guess.
Well, we hope you have success. There's a lot of bands trying to do that at the moment, and a few radio shows too.
Yeah, but not enough. There needs to be more.
Yeah. But we'll get there.
I think so. I mean, I think rock and roll was always an outcast genre anyway, and that's what's good about it, because, you know, if you're into rock or metal, it's scientifically or medically proven fact that you're more intelligent than the average human being.
Oh, that's nice to know.
Yeah, look it up. It's in all the... You know, when you go to the doctors and there's all those books behind the doctor, it's mentioned in them.
Right. I was talking to someone from a heavy metal band recently who said that all you heavy metal girls are screwed up somehow.
All the heavy metal girls.
Yeah, screwed up.
I think all girls in general, really, aren't they?
Let's not go there, shall we? I was liking...
That's why guys write so many songs about girls, because they've spent an eternity trying to figure them out, and no one can, you know? So I don't think it matters what kind of music they listen to. I think it's just girls in general.
Yeah, well...
But, you know, what else would we have to write about?
The same can be said the other way around, but I like you at the moment, so let's get off that subject. We should actually tell people, too, that you can be found at arcanesaints.com.
Yes.
And people can buy your music there and keep up with your concert dates.
They can get our CD, whether it's a physical copy or a copy from iTunes. Just either go directly to iTunes, or it's also available in JB Hi-Fi, so you can get it from your local JB Hi-Fi store. And if they've run out of their copies, which they often do, just ask them to order more in. Otherwise, yeah, just go to our website, arcanesaints.com, and grab a copy from there.
You haven't made any videos for the new releases yet?
No, because we're too poor, and videos cost money. But we've made one ourselves, and that's on our website. Our lead guitarist, Cheat, made it.
Is that the one that's in the studio?
Yeah, it's in the studio. So you also get to see, like, you know... It's a music video, and it's also what went on in the studio, you know?
Right, over in Nashville.
A little bit of background knowledge, yeah, over in Nashville, crazy stuff that happened.
Yeah. And so what are you going to do next year? Like, is your day job possibly on the line with going to America?
Yeah, it's always on the line. I've got two day jobs at the moment. seriously, I'm working like 6-7 days a week at the moment to save up for this US tour, because it's costing so much. So what am I going to do? I don't know. The same thing I did when I went to Nashville, and it was kind of just, like, just beg, you know, can I please have a month off? And then, you know, and then... But last time they were actually really supportive. They were like, oh, hell yeah, you're going to Nashville to record an album. Of course you can have a month off. But I'm just thinking I maybe only get that card once, you know. Maybe so. I don't know if it'll work next year. Can I have another month off to tour the US?
We'll get your bosses to love the band that... you're going to tour with first before you tell them.
Yeah.
because then they won't deny it. It's like, oh, yeah, you've got to play with them.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Or I can just take them on tour. You know, I'm sure they'd really appreciate that.
Yeah, and that's why I've got two jobs anyway. So if you lose one, you've still got another.
Exactly. Exactly, yeah. But, yeah, no, it's happened. I know, like, a couple of the other guys. Well, one of the other guys when we went last time was self-employed, so he just gave himself the time off. He was like, you know, can you have the time off? And he said, yeah, I can. So he was, like, really lucky. And then the other guys, they've got the kind of jobs where people don't really notice if they're there or not. So it's just kind of, they just didn't turn up for a month and then just, and they came back after a month and they're like, oh, I haven't seen you in ages, you know. Like, oh, you know, just extended long lunch break or something. So,
Yeah.
I don't even know what they do, actually. I should probably find that out.
Obviously not much, if no one misses them.
And how can I get a job there?
But you won't need it after next year. You'll be so busy touring and making money selling CDs and things over in America. And is there any plans, do you think, for the band to actually end up relocating, or is that something?
It's always in the back of our minds, yeah, to be honest. It just depends on how well our management does for us, I guess. You know, anything could happen as a result of touring with this high-profile band. You know, it could just get us really good exposure, or it could get us on an indie label over there, in which case we'd have to, you know, be, like, semi-permanently located over there so we can tour all the time and stuff. And there's actually a few Aussie bands over there that have actually relocated over there, and they're just touring, because, you know, if you can break the US market, then, you know, it spreads worldwide, then you can come back to Australia and you get taken a lot more serious and all that. So there's a lot of sort of runoff from it. But, yeah, it's something that we'd love to do, yeah, for sure.
Yeah, it's sad that you have to get known overseas before Australia takes notice.
Yeah, it's the same in New Zealand as well. Like, a lot of good bands are just, you know, playing around the pub scene and stuff for years and years, and no one really took much notice of them. And then they went over to either America or the UK. There's a band called the Datsuns. Do you remember them?
Yeah, I remember them.
Yeah, and they got massive, didn't they? And they were just playing around for years in pubs, and no one really took much notice of them in New Zealand at all. Then they went over and did some shows in London and somehow got on the cover of NME magazine, and suddenly they were just, like, you know, the heroes of New Zealand. It's like, you know, these guys have been playing around for 5 years and no one took any notice, but as soon as they're on the magazine cover from overseas, everyone loved them.
Yeah.
So it's a bit sad, and it's kind of the same in Australia as well, but it's just one of those things, I guess.
Oh, well.
Yeah.
But I'm sure you're going to do it anyway. You'll get known overseas, and then everyone over here will take notice.
I hope so. We just want to get to the stage where we can actually make a living off it and not have to just be exhausted all the time, you know, and broke all the time.
Well, good luck with that. I really hope it does happen for you, and you've got everything you need going for you at the moment. So hopefully the tide has turned, and, yeah, turning the tide is probably what you've done yourselves anyway, with your persistence.
Yeah.
And people can find you at facebook.com/arcanesaints as well.
Yeah.
And they can go and like you and keep up to date with everything you're up to.
Yeah, they can like us. They can send us nude selfies if they're attracted. They can say, they can write us love poems, you know, whatever tickles your fancy.
Are you going to write them back?
No.
No.
Not me personally, no way. We hire people to do that for us.
So you're already Americanized.
Yeah, we've got little elves, they do it for us. They're really good at it. Actually, if you go on our Facebook page, there's a really nice pic of Katy Perry, and you can have a look at her.
Yeah, holding a sign with Arcane Saints on it.
Yeah, yeah. How good is that? Do you know why? Because a lot of people thought that we were making up the whole celebrity thing. They thought, oh, you know, this band's just trying to get votes by saying these celebrities are helping them. So she got a bit annoyed about it and wrote this sign saying, what did it say? I don't even care.
We are all praying for you. Can't wait to see you on tour. Bring the sunshine, Arcane Saints. Love, yeah. Katie.
Yeah, so that was really nice of her to do. And you know what? And everyone was like, oh, you photoshopped it. It was like, we can't win.
Oh, well, one day they'll know it's true.
Yeah.
Because
we're actually hanging out with her, and I don't know, maybe we're on stage with her or something like that. I'm sure that would go down really well with her fan base.
Well, I'm sure once someone in America takes notice of you, then other people start to too.
Yeah, exactly.
They hear about you.
Maybe they'll hear about us on the show.
Yeah. And Yeah, you've got two shows coming up. You've got one in Canberra in January on the 11th as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, we're really excited about that because we haven't played Canberra before. So Sheep, our lead guitarist, has got family out there, so and they haven't seen us before, so that's going to be pretty cool.
Yeah.
And, yeah, so we're doing that. And then straight after there's Big Day Out.
The 24th of January yeah. in Melbourne yeah. at Big yeah. Day Out. Cool.
Yeah, so pumped for that one.
And people can get hold of your debut album, Turning the Tide, if they go to your Facebook or to your website, arcanesaints.com.
Or iTunes or JB Hi-Fi.
Mm.
Yep.
Okay, so it is in JB Hi-Fi.
It is, yeah.
Cool.
Well, apparently it is. I've been into a couple and it hasn't been there.
Oh, is it distributed through MGM or someone?
No, it's distributed through Firestarter.
All right, so people can probably go into their local JB and
yeah,
and ask.
You can definitely request it from JB Hi-Fi. I know when it first came out, most stores stopped only about two or three copies, you know, being an unknown indie band such as ourselves. So a lot of people just went in and just got snapped up straight away, but they didn't replace the stock. But right. I think it takes like 1 or 2 days to order in if it's not already in there.
Yeah, yeah. But people can
But who buys CDs anyway, you know? Everyone's on iTunes these days. I buy CDs, but...
Yeah, not everyone. They're actually, vinyl's making a comeback too.
Mm.
So
it's been making a comeback for about 20 years, hasn't it?
Yeah, probably.
Ever since it came out, it's been making a comeback.
Ever since it went away, yeah.
Yeah. Well, I like vinyl. I don't even know how to work a record player. That whole needle thing just confuses me. I guess I'm young enough to say that, but I'm also old enough to still buy CDs, so I don't really know. I'm sort of in between, I guess. But I like vinyl. I just like the look of it. I'd like to see one of my own albums in vinyl. I think we should do a limited edition run.
Yeah, and if you ever come up the studio, I'll teach you how to use the record player in here.
Awesome. Okay. That sounds good. See, we've got a job for you. That's your job.
Yeah.
Job is to teach us old technology that's not...
yeah, because
anymore.
Because I'm old, I remember how to use a record player.
There you go.
Well, it has been great talking to you.
Okay, it's always a pleasure.
Thank you. And we will play one of your tracks right now off the debut album because the Never Say Die, as you informed me, is actually one of your old ones that I played before.
Yeah, it's an old one, but it's a good one.
It is.
Yeah.
But we're going to go out or say goodbye to you with Hard to Please, which is on your album. And I have been playing a few different tracks from the album.
Oh, cool. Thank you for that.
Although I played Never Say Die a couple of times thinking it was from the album.
That's all right. A lot of people still really like that song.
So I've got it in the wrong folder.
Like, you should have done that song and put it on the album, but we're kind of, you know, we'd already recorded it as a single and released it on iTunes and stuff, so we're kind of done with it at that point. But a lot of people were going, why didn't you put that on the album?
Oh, maybe a remix on your next album.
Mm. I think we'll do like a dubstep version or something.
Yeah. Thanks a lot, and good luck with the new year and that and everything that's going to happen. And
thank you.
Make sure I'm one of the first to know when you can say the name of that band.
Yes. You will be.
Cool.
Maybe we'll give you like the exclusive rights and you can announce it on your show first.
Oh, that'd be awesome.
Yeah. It'll either be you or it'll be like Women's Weekly.
See, I'm going to make sure that this part goes public so that I can keep you to it.
Okay.
It's been great. Thank you.
Thanks, Kat.
Bye.
Thanks, Kat.
Bye.